TUCN, CSTS, the specific program is the South Asian Dialogues on Ecological Democracy and the Center for Equity, the Center for Equity Studies. And the idea here really is to address the issue of early detection of starvation. And we are trying to make this a forum where we discuss and consult on developing socio-medical tools for defining early identification of acute hunger and starvation for effective administrative action. We have around the table several distinguished scientists, nutritionists, and social activists. The idea of this consultation was conceived by Professor Ritupriya. She has really managed to bring together all of you, and so without further ado, I will hand over the proceedings to Professor Ritupriya.
Can you hear me fine? Very pleased to see that we have around the table academics from the university and from colleges, but also administrators who handle the issues that we're talking about. This interface seems to be an important one, which has been happening over the years. But on the issue of malnutrition, somehow the acute malnutrition seems to have fallen between the cracks in any way. We have ways of identifying and dealing with chronic malnutrition, but acute malnutrition is dealt with either in terms of starvation or, as is now common with the development circles and child health, MAM, SAM, and it has been the current jargon, which is moderate acute malnutrition, severe acute malnutrition, and global acute malnutrition. So, on one hand, we have approaches which look at universal PDS, food security, and so on, and macro issues. On the other hand, we have these absolutely micro issues of MAM and SAM. And the meso level, when we look at acute malnutrition as a collective phenomenon, which needs to be dealt with, has not got what one would consider adequate attention, especially at a time when in the past years we had drought conditions, we got price rise of the kind that we've seen this year, and therefore the possibility of impending large-scale acute malnutrition and all its consequences. In a consultation with administrators and civil society at the beginning of this year in Patna, at the NCNI Institute specifically, one realized that when an interested administrator really asked us as technical people, can you tell us exactly what to do? If I want to prevent that acute hunger in my community, you have to be at a loss to give them exact answers. And that sort of set the tone for saying, can we look at the various dimensions of this issue as a separate focus in itself? There's also the two dimensions to that, again, one identification and the other responding to it. And the response is the crucial part, but that can happen only if there is recognition and identification. And so this one way is focused on acute malnutrition, on identification, on definition, identification, verification, and methods to do that. Methods to do that, not only at a level where you can study it adequately for in-depth, but also with tools that administrators can use as quick, rough, and ready tools to act immediately when the disaster is happening, when the acute malnutrition is happening on a large scale, rather than post facto studying its various dimensions, which is important. But the action has to happen if we have to do prevention. And that's really the focus today. So it's not chronic malnutrition, which is the big picture. And that's why we've been focused more on that chronic than on the acute malnutrition. And very rightly so. But there is this gap which today we are trying to address. The phenomenon has, in the last few years, a lot of what I would consider seminal work has been done by the Janswastha Abhiyan Hunger Watch Group and the Commissioner's Office. But somehow that doesn't seem to have been taken note of either by the mainstream public health or nutrition spheres or civil administration or policy makers. And somehow those are where we need to bring this into focus again. And therefore that's the morning session, deals with the work that these two bodies have done and what are the technical dimensions of that. We we have a discussion on the experience of using that, and then we all with our experience talk about how, what is the strength it brings into the system and what more we can be done. Other dimensions, other ways. Starvation, death gives us one way of identifying the fact that there is acute hunger in a serious way. Can there be other tools that can be used by civil administration to do that early enough and take preventive action? We're going to suggest many others, and we'd like the experts and the experienced person around the table to look at the feasibility of those methods or the desirability of those methods. Do they need to be developed more? We need them still at an absolutely proposal stage. And is it even meaningful to work on them, to develop them further, is the purpose of the second session in the afternoon. So how we structure this is that in the morning we start first with Harshbag with the experience of the commissioner's office putting the challenge, and he says challenging the technical people, because that's where he finds there is a gap and we need to perform better on that, and we can use. Secondly, I come to the public health approach of clarifying some of the issues that we need to have on a common platform, because one finds there's a lot of definitions and a difference of language as we come from different disciplinary and experiential backgrounds. And then Mandana will talk about the GSA model and how they have developed the guidelines, the considerations behind that, all the technical considerations as well as the social considerations that went into it. After that, the floor is open, and we'd like to go around the table taking each of the various proposed methodologies to, you know, sort of pull them apart, discuss them threadbare to see what are the possibilities and where we'd like to go from there. What kind of work would be required in the future so that we develop in this area and prevent the hunger and starvation rather than studying it post facto. There is material in the folder that you've got, which we try to put together both from the commissioner's office and the kind of reports and guidelines. The GSA guideline is in the document, and we hope you can look at that as one of the tools. We have some papers which, from nutritionists and public health people, showing the linkages between the various types of malnutrition and their link with health and disease, and the implications of that for administrative action. Many of the reports are very bulky and huge documents. They're outside for you to look at, and anybody who's interested could then let us know, and we could make copies and get them sent, or soft copies could be sent to you. So please take a look outside if you don't match time or in the day. I think I'll stop there, and maybe we can have a quick round of introduction so we're all familiar with each other. As others, when you come in, you can then also get them introduced, of course. So,
my name is Harshvardhan. I work in the hunger institution and other forms of institutions. Here I am interested in the colleagues of my work as the institution of the institution.
I'm Dr. Vikas Bajpayee, and I am a PhD student at the institution.
Impact on the livelihood of the Bihar. Good morning. I'm Shilpa Deshpande. I'm from the ICHA Center for Child Health and Nutrition, Pune. This is a grant-making and research group that's focused on facilitating community action and strengthening public services to improve child health and nutrition.
Good morning. My name is Priya. I'm from the ICHA Center as well. And I'm working primarily in
I am D. Banerjee. I am Professor Emeritus at the Center of Social Medicine.
I am Uttar Patel, student of Sociology, JNU.
Good morning. I am Alan Nanda. I am I just submitted my actual dissertation, and it was on the quality of services and ICTS.
I'm CJ Malik. I'm a fellow at Community Medicine in Bangalore, and I'm a volunteer at ICT. These are some of the things we work on.
Thank you. of transfer, and they have less access to other forms of food, making buses, meat products, or poultry. So therefore, there is a real data to show that hunger has got more aggravated in the last 15 years. Unfortunately, this is not accepted by the people. Government of India may be saying that 46% children are malnourished, out of that 17% children are really malnourished. But this is not the data of the state government. The state government data shows a very different picture. State government data shows that the number of malnourished children has declined from 95 to 95, from something like 18% to 8%. Only 8% children are malnourished. Now for that, only 1% children are severely malnourished. So there is a problem with this. They say you can't be holding any restaurants when you are wasting money. Because there is no problem. There is only 1% children for people in malnourishment. So that is the data with the state government. I think our first job would be to make the state government realize that this is all bogus data. That this is all deliberately under-reported in order to save attention by media or by the officers. So therefore, unless there is a match between the national family health survey data and the state data, there would be a problem of denial by the state governments. So I see that as a very serious problem that the state governments do not accept that the number of civilly managed children. In many drops that I've learned and seen, this is even less than 1%. I remember in Kalamandir district, the average was only 1.2%. One of the hungriest districts in India reporting only 1.1% children as a malnourished. And that is what the state commission reported on the board of the assembly also. So that is, I think, serious issue that we should consider. In addition, this is the last point I make, that there is a problem of governance. Because when you look at the profile of the Ministry of the Departments of Women and Child Development, you find that at the state level, this is not considered an important department. And what is worse is in the last 10 years, after the Supreme Court's election to this issue, and after we succeeded in increasing budget allocations for the Department for the Institution, the net result has been just the reverse. The net result has been that the department is seen as a place that a lot of money can be made. Right from our Anganwadi worker up to the CBPO or whatever. Everyone was informed the Department of Women and Child Development that they raised a lot of money can be made in a very short time. So therefore the net result of our effort has not been very positive as regards to the plan on children. And of course, the ICDS that you all know so much from it serious design flaw, which is the development after the age group 1 year, 6 months to 2 years, which is the main age group we should be addressing. It looks after the age group 3 to 6 years, where there is this kind of money to be made because of the nutrition that we care for 3 to 6 years. So therefore I feel that yes, there is a need to set a protocol for identifying the hungriest and the severely malnourished. But that would happen only when the governments will never accept in governments report. There is no diagnosis of starvation. We may die of other forms of diseases, but not of starvation. So therefore, all we can do is succeed in ensuring slippers of severely malnourished children and severely malnourished adults who is connected. It is connected to her and it matches with the national family health figures. In fact, the problem of governance is so serious that I don't know if I should say it, but since this is open, I was addressing the meeting of MPs. About 40 MPs had come to the professional block about a week or 10 days back, and we were discussing these issues. And one of the MPs was bored enough to say, I told them all to prepare the MPs to monitor. I said, you must go and see if you can yourself, you find that the number of children would be only 5 or 6 to 1 to 200. The number of people who get married would be X, or if not, it's 200 deaths, etc., etc. One of the MPs said, no, sir, this is not our problem. Our problem is, otherwise, I'm going to come to us, and she said that, look, the person, the supervisor, is asking from me 4,000 people per month. Please get used to 2,000. So I am there to negotiate between the Anganwadi worker and the supervisor to see how this kind of a poverty of money can be distributed in an equitable manner. So they are trying to create equity in their own way. So this is the status of governance in our community that we need to keep in mind. I will not take much of the time, but I know there are many serious issues to discuss. And with this, I now request Harsh to make his presentation on charities and talent foundation and verification of establishing there.
Thank you, Mr. Sayyad, and to all of you gathered here today. This session, what I tried to do is to recount briefly the kind of challenges not in the content of response, but in the way process that we do, that is like another day's discussion. Not in the content of the total public policy response to starvation but the challenges of understanding what is wrong, how do you define them, how do you identify them. That is what we will be discussing today. I'll recount based on viewers' experience, looking at a very large number of challenges covered in deaths in a number of states, including in the world of sleep consumption. And I will say this as well. Let me start by saying that starvation is a challenge firstly to the Muslim people. That's really, what challenges it poses is something that I just very quickly like to start with it. We try to talk with people who live with hunger and they of life and severe denial of food as a way of life. And we discovered a number of ways in which they survive. Some of them I just briefly recount. The first thing that they said was largely by cutting back on their food intake. Going down to 3 weeks to the and their body, adjusting their bodies over periods of time where people longing for that food is somehow mitigated so that they can deal with that suffering. A second broad category that of responses that we have observed was is what I would describe as identifying pseudo food. Things that are available free, like grasses and tubers and other things, in the environment which have no nutritional value, sometimes have negative poisons and other effects, but will enable you to fill your stomach and get a sense of of satiation. And there's a, you know, I'm probably discovering is that there's a tragic, cultural practices which I think are both we understood. In each location where people live different ways, and that people in grasses which are poisonous with the boils and the water is there's also we found fake the neighbors for these starch water that after the crisis everything that overnight is permanent and the land becomes very so I think this pseudo food is broadly how we describe and a third is a third broad category of responses is what I would describe as desperate services. Where you put your small child up to your age of one day, to library, to the difficult circumstances, to sell your body, to do serious things. Some of the desperate choices is also about accepting old people because desperate old people simply cannot live without working. If they are very last, their body will be more and more, more difficult for them, but they have to accept and work to give them as charity in some way. Work is very my kindness to old person is that I'm giving them taking my kindness to the person. It has been much harder work. So we make choices which are completely unusual that seems to be dealing with things. Deep experience of hunger. There's a big need there is the hardest lesson of all that people talk about. Their children is a lesson of how to speak hungry. Again, their cultural practices around that. There's a meaning of food people from Sahara and other communities tell us. Which I found also in some other cultural practices. Now, I want to start with this simply because that is the background in which I want to have this discussion today. It is the background for something like 5-10% of our world's people. He said something to me which is very profound. Modern labor we often assume is the last, the most desperate of our world. But he said it's not really the case because people get quantity with the labor to give in one day. What happens is people don't even have the labor to give in one day. Those are the people that I really want to focus our attention on. So let's move then to the public policy challenge. The public policy challenge famously Martha says that democracy is not valuation, but at least valuation is acknowledged to some degree before the qualifications that Dr. Sitter has spoken about. But the existence of hunger, individual starvation or starvation within communities is almost completely invisibilized in public policy discourse. We have a famine quote which we still use in many states. This is related to the same language, the famine quote. people in this country. And it is one of the documents that I think this will be printed out, so it's in the folder. It's in fact we sent it to the state government, to the central government, and the Supreme Court asking for some modified version of this. But I would say that, you know, was tempted that we should go to that day when we will discuss it. Let us postpone that, because for a corruption code to come into force, we have to have an agreement for what we mean by corruption. I'll come to that a bit later when I say that the challenges to the socio-medical community of social scientists and health public health practitioners is where I come to. But let me again briefly touch on what is the typical public policy response to this allegation. The first one is, I would say a little provocatively, is of subtlety. And I recall when I was in training in the Suri Academy, one of the first lectures that we were looking for was how to deal with competent tips of effective administration. And one of the tips that he gave was that, you know, very, very, I think, useful to people like this establishing there. So you should have a bag of paint, something nice up to them. But what he said was that as soon as there is an allegation, there should be slightly instructions for the body. But he should throw 5 kilos of paint into the window of that house. So that when these people come to investigate, you will have to say that no, there is a drain in the house. So how could you have it? And of course, completely foolish even in ethical terms. But this was really, I have to say that one public policy is not just a denial of active subjects, where you actually tie your way as a public policy out of the allegation. A second is of denial, and which is a very, very angry denials that typically follow any allegations. Link to this is the beginning of the picture, when you say one of the victim, you know, this is a message that has done 100 million allegations. And it's always this pattern of saying, no, that person was privileged and they didn't do this, but there's the superstitious and did not take care of them. Basically, blaming the victim. Just indifference. I would say the one thing that the organization has brought about is, at least earlier there was a means of denial. Today there's increasingly an indifference. So what? It's not even an issue. And there's poor knowledge, technical and administrative. The net outcome of this is that the misfortune of having established in your family is compounded by the misfortune of the policy responses to that. And it's often due to the enormous humiliation of that family. And so you have, you know, people who sort of become a big enough issue in the media to burn into that household and cut open the stomach of the dead body. And the kind of questions that are asked, there is a whole process which is very disrespectful of the suffering of the person and the family that is aware of. In fact, the HRC some years, especially with Jawaharlal, had done a series of investigations into the policies of the HRC. Issues of establishing the university. And he said something that I think I would recommend us to consider. He said that the analysis of the university is established. He said there will be no discussion or investigation into the question of whether a particular death is being established. The investigation has to be used to people living to establish. So if there's an allegation of death, no one will investigate that transcript, that person will investigate that transcript. So, living with hunger is what we have said in our tradition to living with starvation, and the state is also, and we need to do that family, community, etc. In relation to findings that people are driving with living with starvation. Now, finally, I want to come to the board calories that is being observation to me, this is the bonus for dominance of seeing a person is destitute or a family person. Then we have a definition of destitute, which is the more, which has, looking at the socio economic condition. And I would just suggest the situation that the institution would involve long-term denying to work, to pay employment, to food necessary for survival. And it often also related to extreme social stigma and social taboos. And in many conditions, especially in the urban context, so is that conceptual of government can you also work towards psychologically and medically appropriate definition of destitution? Because I think that that is what you would, if we are going to shift to investigating living with starvation, I would assume that we are investigating destitution. Then let me just pose a few more questions in my experience. We talk about acute hunger. Now, is acute hunger the same thing as starvation? We sometimes talk about acute malnutrition. Is that the same thing as starvation? We talk about acute undernutrition. Is that the same thing as starvation? If not, what are the differences between these two terms? I'm not clear. Now we started talking about severe acute malnutrition. Now what is severe acute malnutrition? Is that starvation? If not, what is the difference between severe acute malnutrition and acute malnutrition? What is the difference between acute malnutrition and severe acute malnutrition and starvation? I'm not sure. Then we talk about chronic malnutrition. And here, again from public policy perspective, it's very important that we talk about the law and for day 3, day 4. And there's an entire system of now we have been told that grade 3, grade 4 is getting out of grade and we should be talking about SAM. Now, if you talk about SAM, then where is the chronicness and where is the acuteness? Why are we abandoning the old definition of grade 3, grade 4? And when we are, and we are replacing it with the notion of acute malnutrition, then why is the chronicness? Then my understanding is just death result from acute malnutrition or acute malnutrition layered on a foundation of chronic malnutrition. So our business starvation a combination of chronic and acute malnutrition. If so, can we define it more precisely? And the last thing that here I can say that our discussion will focus on children, children below the age of 6 and children above the age of 6. I think we have to also bear in mind, just anecdotally, in an Amish, Bhojan was here, he did not be able to come to one of our advisors. He documented some 2,000 or so starvation kids or any starvation kids across. I find starvation with small children, but also in old people without stress, I find it in single women, it is also where the woman tends to be the one who starves to death. And I find it in disabled people, it is also sometimes where disabled children, I mean, unrelated to the same phenomenon of many disabled children and families because of having and if there is a disabled child, one caregiver gets devoted to one and is devoted to the care of that child, which is usually the woman, and we find that the man tends to break spirit, and the spirit tends to break. So he's left as the only veteran, and he also tends to do a very erratic. That becomes another set of disability
needs.
So single woman has four different outcomes, disability seems to be high susceptibility to destitution and starvation. So the point that in the last one I want to make is that why we have these discussions, let us think about, remember infants and children, but also remember disabled people as categories, etc. And we have to have definitions and education methods to apply to all of these. So I'd like to conclude here, and as I said, that my request is then, and the reason for this roundtable really was motivated from our side was that if we work towards, I don't think we have final answer, in work towards acknowledging whether even my questions are appropriate or inappropriate. If they're inappropriate, let us clarify why. And then it just comes to the least simple question and then look towards answer and work towards answer. Because if we expect the state to be responsible and accountable for responding to starvation, we need to know what it is.
Thank you very much for raising a large number of very important issues.